Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 11th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. Before we begin, a reminder that social distancing measures are in place at Holyrood. Please observe these as you enter and leave the committee room. We have apologies from Natalie Dawn. We also have apologies from Colette Stevenson, who has been substituting for Natalie, and she sends her apologies to the committee. At item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda item three in private. Item three is consideration of the evidence we will hear this morning in relation to COP26 outcomes. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. We are agreed. Our first item of business today is an evidence session on the outcomes of COP26 and early views from experts on its implications for the climate change policies we have in Scotland. This week we have two panels, and for the first panel I am delighted to welcome Professor Dave Ray, Executive Director, Edinburgh Centre for Carbon Innovation, and Mike Robinson, Chief Executive, Royal Scottish Geographical Society. Good morning to both of you. We're delighted you could join us this morning to provide your early insights into the outcomes of COP26. Professor Ray, thank you for your written submission. That was a very useful overview of your initial thoughts on COP26. I also believe that you would like to make a short opening statement this morning before we move on to questions. So I will hand over to you.
Thanks a lot, Convener, and thank you to the committee for having me along. I know that you heard from Malini and Jim last week, so I'm going to keep this fairly quick. I was also looking, actually, at what Alistair's produced and the SPICE team, which is really good in terms of a summary of COP. I guess one of the things I was just going to highlight that I hopefully came through in my what I submitted was some of the implications for Scotland, which I guess we'll talk about in more depth. One of the main things was just the amount of attention on Scotland at COP because of our ambitious targets, because of us essentially being further down the line than a lot of nations in terms of trying to do this. And so a lot of attention in terms of how we're getting on, how we're dealing with some of the barriers, some of the opportunities, and hopefully sharing mistakes that may have been made along the way as well. So that was really good to see, and obviously the COP itself, I think Glasgow and Scotland did a great job at hosting it. Some of the things that came through, so there was a lot of attention around our targets, as well as all of the kind of the targets that nations have submitted and committed to. So the nationally determined contributions through to 2030, obviously, but also the long-term ones. And one of the key issues that I guess will keep coming back for rich countries like ours is whether those targets are actually aligned with the Paris climate goals. And as has been talked about at length over the years, they are in terms of if you just take into account what our emissions are now, but actually the fair share estimation in terms of our historical emissions and our capacity to act means actually we need to go much further in other ways. So that was something that came through at quite a few events at COP. The other thing that came through really strongly, and this is why it's so good that you've got this inquiry coming up for your committee, was around local action. So it was supposed to be all about an implementation COP and this year of action and decade of action for the Paris Agreement. And so local government, cities, communities, lots of discussion about how this actually works on the ground. So I think you're spot on in terms of your focus on that, your upcoming inquiry. And the other thing I did mention in my submission was around the just transition. So that is something that I think a lot of the world see, again, Scotland as a test bed for in terms of how that can be achieved. And I think it's going to become a bigger and bigger issue as we go through this year towards COP27. So the example of South Africa and their kind of moving away from coal, but how that's actually supported and the number of jobs in that industry, a bit like oil and gas here in Scotland, that's going to be so crucial in terms of those nationally determined contributions actually being realised, so them being sustainable domestically rather than politically becoming infeasible because the just transition is not achieved. So my summary, very, very kind of hopefully succinctly, was around whether COP26 was a success. And I'm always a massive over-optimist, so I went into COP thinking, okay, this is probably the most science-based COP there's ever been in terms of the Sticks Assessment Report, Working Group 1 report being already out and hopefully action taken on that. And so alignment with 1.5 in terms of the commitments was what I guess my dreams were made of. I kind of knew that that was not going to be the case. I guess all of us did. There was a slight closing there, but nowhere near enough. There's lots of good things, and Jim and Malini covered a lot of those last week with you. But in terms of 1.5, which is a crucial target for the world, COP26 failed to deliver alignment with that. So we've still got that 1.5 alive in terms of the physics of climate change. But in terms of the reality of delivering on it, time is so tight. And I guess this year ahead, running up to the Egypt COP, is going to be the make or break in terms of that target. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Ray, for those remarks. Mr. Robinson, did you wish to make a brief opening statement before we move to questions?
Yeah, that might be helpful just to give some broad reflections, if that's okay, convener. Again, like Dave, I think no surprise, COP as it stood was a little bit of a disappointment on some levels. Moving, 2.4 degrees is not the outcome we were looking for. It's a lot better than 3.7 that we had out of Paris, but we're, as we all know, we still have some distance to go. But I think it's also important that it's not portrayed as some sort of abject failure either, because it isn't. It's just that would be to misunderstand the United Nations process, I think. And I think really what came out of it for me is a reminder, if I needed one, that the UN process is slow, cumbersome and tortuously complex, and of course can only usually move at the speed of the slowest contributor. And it does make you wonder if there are other mechanisms to help move some of this agenda forwards. Are there actually some items that can be taken off the table and dealt with separately? A good example from our perspective would be around cement, which is a critical issue. 7% global emissions could be dealt with much more easily out with that process, probably in a sort of Montreal Protocol style agreement. In terms of Scotland, I think Scotland performed actually quite well at COP. It was recognised for its ambition around legislation, and certainly a lot of the actions that we were involved in, a lot of the work we were involved in, was around actually lifting the profile of some of what's going on in Scotland. Not to pretend that we have done enough, but we're still on ahead of a journey that a lot of people are on, and it's important that we share that learning. And I think there was a real appetite from delegates that I came across in Blue Zone, Green Zone and in the NGO communities to find out more about what's actually been going on here. And I do think that lends itself both to some potential for increased moral leadership, but also opportunity too, certainly in terms of expertise and academic and business opportunity. I'd like to think there are opportunities too in terms of the alliances. I did one presentation in the Nordic zone, Nordic Pavilion, and there are clearly countries that are more progressive around this agenda. I think there's some really exciting potential for Scotland to develop those relationships with the more progressive nations. But at the same time, I think we've got to look at those that are dragging their heels. And some of those are countries that we have very close affinity with, the USA, Canada, and particularly Australia. And I think we've actually got to see that as an opportunity to help them properly get on board with this journey and do more and take this more seriously and maybe take some of the fear out of it for them as well. So I'd like to think that it isn't over yet. We haven't handed over to Sharm El Sheikh. We've sort of got the chair for the next year. The UK has the chair for the next 12 months. I think we've still got some work to do.
Thanks very much, Mr. Robinson, and thank you both for those introductory remarks. I wonder, it would be helpful for the committee if you could elaborate further on those initial observations in terms of the major outcomes which you did view as a success and areas where you think more action is required. Professor Ray, you mentioned there was no giant leap forward to limit warming to 1.5 degrees, but you also pointed out to major steps forward in a basket of key climate issues such as transparency, carbon markets and coal. And I guess a related question is, are we now moving onto a sort of annual COP process where every year there is going to be a significant conference to update targets, as opposed to previous times where the cycle seemed to be a sort of 3 to 5 year cycle. I'll start with Professor Ray and then bring in Mike Robinson.
Yeah, so it's a really good question, Convener. I mean, I think, as you saw from the cover text in terms of the pact, there is a request that nations provide updated commitments in 2022, so for COP27. That is something which is, it could be a one-off. I mean, it kind of recognises the fact that the ratchet mechanism, of which COP26 was the first ratchet of the Paris Agreement, the ratchets are too far apart, so they're 5 years apart, so the next one would have been, I guess, 4 years down the line, because we were a year late in terms of COP26. But in terms of where we are with emissions and alignment with the Paris climate goals, it kind of recognises that. Whether that will become a regular thing in terms of every year there'll be that request in the text for new NDCs to come forward, we'll see, because I think there's a big question about, I think there are about 40 nations that didn't even submit for this COP, for COP26, an updated nationally determined contribution. Many will say that it's a lot of effort, it's a lot of work to do, particularly if you're a small state, and so expecting them to do that again next year and go beyond what they've already done, that's a bit of a challenge. And it was interesting what John Kerry said about the US NDC, is that, and this is, you know, this is someone who obviously was really pushing for a lot of action internationally at COP, was he kind of equivocated a bit in terms of whether you would see an updated NDC from the US, because it depends on their domestic circumstances. And so I think it's great to have it in there in that cover text, and we definitely do need to see that increased ambition, because we're a long way off, like Mike was saying. Let's see how many nations actually follow through with that, and whether it becomes an annual event. I, from a scientific point of view, given where we are and having to close that gap rapidly, we can't wait 5 years to do that. And so having an annual update to NDCs with increased ambition is what we need. But you need the support for all nations to be able to do that. And obviously not all of them actually have that capacity.
Thank you very much. And Mike Robinson, same question to you.
Thank you, Convener. One of the key things with the UN is it's clearly has a problem with speed of progress. You know, it's taking 26 years to get to where we are now and finally mentioned fossil fuels as a problem. We do need to find a way to urgently increase the speed of decision making. I think that's true domestically as much as it is internationally. The annualisation of commitments is, in theory, is a good idea, but as Dave said, if they don't have the domestic support, they're not going to bring forward new commitments, and it's a danger of leaving more and more people behind. So I think what it does do is it highlights the frailties of the UN process, and it does start to beg the question of where else can, how can you move this forward in different ways? And I think things like Scotland's co-chair of the Under 2 Coalition is a good example where there is an opportunity to create, as I say, alliances with the progressive nations that are moving this forward and start actually working more collaboratively across that group. And it's not just nations, it's also places like California, which is clearly ahead of the curve. There are real opportunities there, and I think it's really important that they start to show more leadership, and I think Scotland's got a role there. But even domestically, I think there is an issue around the speed of decision making. It's a difficult thing to speed up, but I generally sense that if we're going to solve this crisis, we need to slow down politics and speed up decision making, and both of those things are quite challenging.
Thank you very much. One more question from me, then I'll bring in Mark Ruskell. In the areas where real progress was made at COP26, and for example, I think carbon markets have been highlighted, coal, increasing transparency and reporting requirements, how might these outcomes impact policy in Scotland and the rest of the UK? And what might be the practical implications for governments and businesses arising from the outcomes in these areas? Professor Ray, I'll start with you again.
Yeah, so for me, a real positive was the Paris rule book in terms of a lot of that being agreed in a way which closes some of the loopholes. A crucial one, like you say, in terms of markets, was avoiding double counting, certainly between trades in emissions between nations. And there's going to be a real role probably for you in terms of Parliament as well as governments in terms of those carbon markets, particularly the voluntary carbon markets, how they actually operate in the context of what's being agreed under Article 6 in that case, in terms of what credits are authorised. If you have authorised credits as a nation, then the idea is if you sell those, then you have to take them off your balance. So there isn't double counting. Where there's still a grey area and probably where regulation is going to have to play a role is in that voluntary carbon market, where you've got essentially projects which a company might be funding and claiming those emission reductions, and there's no corresponding reduction in terms of where those reductions happen in terms of the national accounting. So that is going to be something where, if you were really wanting to play the text of the Paris Agreement and what came out of Glasgow as well, as a company, you could go down a greenwashing line, actually, in terms of what you're actually doing. So you're counting emission reductions, which actually are already part of a nation's efforts in terms of cutting their emissions. And that, at least, was made really overt in the discussions in Glasgow. And it's something where it will come down to all of the states to look at how their voluntary carbon markets are working. Actually, whether it does need intervention or whether the market will look after itself in terms of that distinction, because we've kind of got two tiers now of credits based on the outcome, which is if we've got those authorised credits, then we know that they are going to be not double counted. They're going to be real reductions which aren't kind of copied somewhere else, and the atmosphere will see just that reduction. But we've got this other tier, which is outside of those authorised credits, where some attention probably needs to be put on it in terms of for Scotland, for the government and the Parliament, potentially also the courts. But this is an issue for all nations, is to make sure that double counting is avoided.
Yeah, it's a fascinating area. Mike Robinson, same question to you, please.
Thanks, Convener. Again, agreed, the issue of double counting is critical. A great example at home is the whole issue around tree planting in agriculture. If companies start buying up land to put trees in, then you can't use it to offset land management issues. And I think it is going to become an increasing issue. So I think there is a concern there around scrutiny and how we exactly monitor all of that. Some of the issues here are that, obviously, I think the private sector is likely to respond to some of the findings of COP more quickly, potentially, than some other governments, because what they're looking for is trends and certainty. They're still waking up to some of these changes. I still don't think the knowledge and understanding within business community is as high as it should be, considering the importance of this issue. But as this starts to kick in, and both in terms of the certainty of direction, so the moving away from coal, which seems obvious and predictable, but is still surprising some in the business community. But also we're starting to see now some of the sort of financial ratchets moving ahead. And I think the other thing that I felt within COP, within particularly some of the fringe activities, was around some of the legal changes that are likely to be coming forward too. So, one of the panels I spoke on was around Stop Ecocide, which is a really significant international campaign to give legal rights to the environment, which would actually start to, again, impact people's bottom line, and I think would make them think a bit harder about how seriously they take this issue. But for me, one of the things that does pop out of all of this, though, as I say, one is that sort of long-term certainty, so people know this is the direction of travel and have confidence that they're going in the right direction. The other is around scrutiny, but more than scrutiny, it's also sense checking. And one of the concerns, I think, is just to ensure that it is, climate is being considered in all of those decision making. I mean, I still think there's room for more knowledge for that on every board in Scotland. And I think that's still something we need to look at.
Thanks very much, Mike. Let me bring in Mark Ruskell to be followed by Liam Kerr.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I was just reflecting on what you were saying there, Mike, around the opportunity to take particular sectors and to develop essentially a protocol. I think you mentioned that in relation to cement. So I was interested perhaps in you just exploring that a little bit more with the committee, because I guess kind of my sense of COP was that, you know, the process is not ideal. I think what happened on the Saturday in particular with the watering down of text and some of the geopolitics around that was deeply worrying. I mean, one of my children watched that and watched the response from other countries around that table, like Switzerland and others, and just found it incredible. So it seems that there's more of a diplomatic effort that's needed in the run-up to these COPs. And I'm interested in kind of how you see particular kind of sector protocols or initiatives actually running in the run-up to COP. And then sort of aligned to that as well, just both of you, some reflections on the various kind of high ambition alliances that are emerging. I mean, there seem to be a kind of more of a informal multilateralism at this COP. I mean, the Costa Ricans were very prominent and have been very prominent in the development of those kind of alliances around nature and high ambition and the Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance as well. So I'm interested in the architecture of all of that from the two of you and what can happen along the side of COP that can then feed into much more ambition in future COPs. So I don't know who, maybe Mike first and then Professor Ray would be good.
Thanks, Mark. So I guess there's lots of different responses to that. Firstly, in terms of there are a number of issues that we know need to be resolved. Arguably, one of the most successful climate agreements up until now has been the Montreal Protocol, which wasn't really intended to be that, of course. It was the removal of CFCs from the atmosphere to prevent the depletion of the ozone layer. But it was achieved relatively quickly. It actually made a difference. It didn't make the whole difference, but it was much easier to deliver because it was a discrete piece of work with a very immediate need. And there is a sense that there are certain aspects of this that can be taken out and dealt with separately and not sitting on the table, conflated by all of the other issues that are there. Of course, there were anxieties and there was disappointment about the way some of the language was watered down. And it's very easy to sort of point fingers at that. And it is frustrating to see that. But equally, there's a number of commitments here that people just aren't actually delivering against, and it's giving people political space to do those sorts of things. So we've all got to sort of, it's really important that there's leadership in this arena. And I think, I believe there's huge opportunity in leadership. And I think there is a need to actually start to look at all of the different mechanisms for building relationships with the progressive countries. Even organizations like mine might not be obvious. We're a tiny charity based in Perth, but we've part of the International Geographical Community. So our connections actually on soft diplomacy are enormous. We can reach really quite interesting people across the world. And I think we just need to start using all of those sorts of mechanisms to help share the examples that we have, the problems that we have, the expertise that we have, because everybody's on this journey. Everybody's on this journey. Some are very reluctant. You know, Australia's right at the back of the queue. Ourselves, Sweden, Costa Rica, right towards the front. But we've still all got a long way to go. So we've got to start to sort of build those sort of soft alliances, I think. And I think I genuinely believe there's real opportunity in that. The likes of something like cement is a really obvious one. It's just a discrete area of work. There's a reason, I think, that part of the reason it's problematic is it's 7% of emissions, very heat-intensive process, and most standards, apart from in Australia, ironically, the standard for the strength of cement is how much Portland it has in it. And there are alternatives to Portland. And so I just think let's just take these sorts of issues off the table and deal with them separately and find a different mechanism to do that. And I think the Progressive Alliances are probably the first port of call to move that forwards.
Dave, do you want to come in? No.
Yeah, thanks, Mark. It's a really good question. I think if I had to list my successes from COP26, they would include things which weren't in any of the formal texts in terms of the pact or anything else. They would be those alliances around. So the deforestation one in week one was because it was so broad and and deep, actually, in terms of additional finance and recognising that a lot of what needs to happen in terms of reducing or stopping deforestation is actually working with the communities which are already protecting those forests. So we've seen commitments like this before around deforestation, but that one kind of spoke volumes in terms of what a huge source of emissions it is and actually how it is, as ever, working on the ground locally, if you want to address that. Methane was another one. All right, China is one of the major emitters, and Russia as well, didn't sign up to it, but actually there's this dialogue between US and China around methane. But that was led by the US, and that spoke volumes to me because it's, as you know, it's a powerful greenhouse gas. It has a real, it causes huge damage in terms of air quality as well, so huge co-benefits in terms of reducing it, and gives you a little bit of a lever there in terms of rapid reductions in the rate of warming because it's short-lived. So those kind of outcomes, I've seen different, it depends if you how you take the spin. So I've seen some saying, well, that's meant an extra 0.2 has been shaved off the warming this century, 0.2 degrees Celsius. More probably robust analysis suggests 0.1, but that's a significant, you know, that's equivalent to a big emitter coming through with a substantially increased a commitment in terms of their NDC. So those kind of mechanisms, like Mike was saying, are really important. They're an important part of COP. They're kind of wrapped up into it, but they allow those coalitions to come together and do stuff which is, in theory, faster and certainly more robust in terms of who is actually going to do what, rather than just getting wrapped up in how can we get out of this or go for the lowest common denominator. So yeah, there were, to be honest, that some of them were disappointing, and that diplomacy in the run-up to COP is a really good point, Mark, is the UK government had its target areas. Cars was one of them, coal was one of those. On cars, that was, you know, fairly underwhelming in terms of that kind of commitment that was made by the coalition that was brought together. But there were some notable successes, I think, in terms of deforestation and methane. As Mike says, you know, things like cement might be another example that we'll see coming through. And I guess it speaks to the frustration of the nation states and what they want to see happen through the UN process. So these kind of coalitions give a way to actually take action, which doesn't need to go through all the way to Alok Sharma's gavel at the end.
Thanks. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mark. Liam Kerr to be followed by Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Convener. Just a very brief question. Mike Robinson, during that discussion, you said that the private sector will respond more quickly to the situation. So what, in your view, ought governments to be doing to either get out of the way of the private sector doing that innovation and or in order to promote that, for example, providing a stable long-term investment environment? What do you think?
I think the private sector wants, they want consistency and clarity of direction more than anything else. And they need to know that that's in place for a period of time. So I guess, how does that translate? I mean, some of the previous tariffs we've had around energy, the sort of feed-in tariffs, renewable heat incentives and things, haven't really stayed there long enough to have the full impact that they could have. Some of the grants and discounts for different interventions as well. So it's that, I do believe that having that sort of more long-term view to that, a consistency and a commitment over a minimum period, probably looking at 15 to 20 years realistically, give certainty that allows them to reposition their organisation more behind it. I do think, it's interesting, I think I've maybe said this before, but it was only 3 years ago I had a meeting with international financiers saying they were surprised that coal had become uninvestable. The signals that COP gave around coal and methane and other things are important because they will trigger sensitivities in the market and in terms of longer term investment by business. And I actually think business will react to that very quickly, as long as they're clear what the solutions are then. And I think one of the reasons we haven't seen more of a shift is two or three reasons, really. But one of them is simply that they're not always clear which bits to then move into, which bits to back. And there's a lack of certainty and clarity sometimes around solutions that I think holds them back. The other thing that holds them back is it doesn't necessarily, you know, it costs, they perceive it as it costing them, and it never costs them to destroy the environment. So we absolutely have to change that somehow, either through financial mechanisms or legal mechanisms. And I think that's why I was quite excited by some of the growing momentum around some of the sort of legalities of this. I still think that's got a very important sort of purpose there too. So hopefully that sort of answers the question.
Yes, I'm very grateful. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Liam. Monica Lennon to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, just a brief question at this point. I was pleased to hear Mike Robinson mention the ecocide events that were happening on the side of COP, if you like, and I also had the chance to attend some of those. Thinking about what both Mike and Professor Ray have said today about the importance of or the opportunity for Scotland to lead the way and to build progressive alliances, what role could Scotland play in terms of that journey towards an ecocide law? I declare an interest as someone who's looking at a members bill right now, but is that a space where Scotland could play a role in terms of both the climate and the nature emergency? Mike, interested to hear your thoughts first.
Yes, 100%. I think the message of COP for me is that actually sometimes you can get lost in what you're doing and you can't see the bigger picture. And actually, one of the things that came home to me very strongly in COP is that actually what's going on in Scotland is quite well understood internationally. And it is important. We're not the only ones. There are other countries doing really good things too. I think the Belgians have been looking very seriously at a point adopting an ecocide law as well. But I think part of the point about this isn't, yes, have we got a role? 100% we have. And I would absolutely love to see the Parliament adopt ecocide into legislation in some form. But I think what's actually really interesting in this as well, that's really important, is it also indicates the momentum in all of this discussion and in all of this behaviour. As the issue becomes more urgent, there are not only are commitments ratcheting up in general, most commitments, but also we're starting to see the sort of, the teeth kicking in as well. You know, they are going to start to be financial mechanisms, financial penalties, and there are going to start to be legal mechanisms and legal penalties. What I find really encouraging about COP on many levels is the momentum around many of these things feels like it's almost reaching a tipping point. And I know from speaking to the Stop Ecocide team that the international momentum around that is actually very, very strong. They're looking for adoption at different levels of government in order to help drive the momentum in the international stage. But having a law of ecocide sitting alongside genocide and war crimes really would absolutely give certainty that this is not an acceptable way to behave. And I think long overdue.
Thank you, Mike. Professor Ray, do you want to add to that?
Yeah, only in that we're going to remain under a lot of scrutiny as a nation, and linked to the ecocide kind of issue is around what we're doing on our whole land use and agriculture policy, as Mike and I have talked about a lot, and I know all of you have as well, in terms of where we are transitioning out of common agricultural policy. We know our natural capital in Scotland is huge, but we are, like other nations, facing a lot of competing interests in terms of how that's protected and best benefits livelihoods, the transition to net zero, how is it resilient. And again, we're having to do this stuff ahead of some other nations, particularly developing nations, but actually a lot of developed world partners as well. They will do this, but they'll look at how Scotland is doing it. Can we realise a just transition for rural communities? Can we realise our carbon targets as well as protecting and enhancing biodiversity? It's always, for me, it's a source of great pride that that nations do look at Scotland, and we've got some really good practice to look to, but it's also a great source of fear that we kind of we make big mistakes on this or we go too slowly, and actually through that, it means other nations don't take action, or they're scared away. They kind of look at peatland restoration, for instance, and go, oh, you know, Scotland are trying to do that, but look, the rate's too slow. And, you know, they're just mired in the mire, as it were. And actually, we've got quite a lot of responsibility, I think, as Scotland, not just from our historical emissions and the Enlightenment, but actually where we are in terms of our progress on climate change, the climate change plan, and our targets, to show the world, you know, in all its glory, any of our successes, but also our failures and mistakes, and explain how they have happened so that other nations, whether big or small, can make the same kind of transition, hopefully, in a faster way than most are committed to at the moment.
Can I just pick up on something that Professor Ray said there? Because I think that point about fear, particularly for politicians, that there are some tough and I suppose brave decisions to be made. I think earlier on you said that this COP has been the most science-based COP. I just wonder where the science will take us by the time we get to COP27. But do you think for leaders, including our own First Minister, they have been on a journey during this COP? Because for the First Minister to say last week in this Parliament that something like Cambo shouldn't go ahead, that appears to be a decision that's reflecting the science, but politically probably a difficult thing to say. Do you think that that movement in position, you know, does that send out a message to other, you know, leaders, other parties, that we have to get with the science, and that means that there is that space for people to change, you know, their mind on long-standing positions?
Yeah, I hope so. I mean, we'll have, Jim's report, so the mitigation report for the sixth assessment report will be out before the next COP. So I think that's due early part of next year, as well as the impacts and adaptation report. So the science basis in terms of underpinning climate action, that's not just mitigation, but that's adaptation as well, will be loud and clear. And hopefully there should be time, I think, to incorporate some of the outcomes from COP into those analyses. So that should be really strong. I think this is, it's talked about a lot in terms of how courageous heads of state have to be, parliaments have to be, so all of you have to be, governments have to be. And it is a time to be so courageous, because the time is so short and because the changes have to be so big. And it really is that monumental shift where we know in the past this has gone horribly wrong when we've made these big changes. You know, the deindustrialisation in the UK and in Scotland, you know, the scarring that we still bear, and other nations, you know, bear those scars, and others have seen what's happened and kind of going, we don't want those scars. So it is being really very brave about making those changes in the context of the pandemic and in the context of electoral cycles. This is also in the context of a climate emergency. And so, you know, there's nothing, you know, being timid just won't cut it in terms of where we need to get to. So yes, I mean, it's really interesting. We had one of the events at COP was meeting with a congressional delegation from the US, the Climate Crisis Committee. In fact, that's a committee your committee definitely should talk to. And they were saying talking about what they had gathered from what we're doing in Scotland and the UK. And they were saying it's such a breath of fresh air to see that politics isn't getting in the way. Some of you might disagree with that. But from their perspective, they see it as such a partisan issue, climate change. And I think one of the, again, going back to why we should be proud in Scotland, is actually if we look at the Climate Change Act, if we look at, you know, the progress that's been made through successive parliaments on climate change, we have managed to take that courageous view, because largely politics have been sidelined ahead of the fact that we need to deal with a climate emergency. And hopefully by continuing on that line, we can show other nations actually that, you know, you can do this, and you can do it in a cross-party way rather than just winning political points.
Thank you very much. It was directed at Dave, but I don't know if Mike wants to add anything, and I'll move on, convener.
If I may,
Yes, please.
I think absolutely leadership is vital. I do joke sometimes that a courageous politician is soon to be an ex-politician. The problem is that, and one of the failings of COP in a way, is that a lot of the politicians there didn't have the majority at home. They didn't have the permission at home to do some of this stuff. And therefore, with the best will in the world, they may respond to international pressure, a bit like Obama did in Paris, where he signed it unilaterally, effectively, but couldn't get it through the Senate. And so it was very easy to reverse. I think the fact that it should be beyond politics, of course it should, and hopefully with the scientific basis to it, that allows it to be seen to be more objective in that sense. But that isn't always the case. And I think one of the things that's really important in this is that we do need to spend time and energy making sure that people are up to speed with this issue. And the thing I have discovered more and more is that actually considering the enormity of this subject is surprising how little a lot of people do actually understand around it. So it's really important, I think, that we, I mean, you will know Dave and I have worked together to produce a qualification climate solutions understanding purposefully, because we recognise that until that understanding, a minimum level of understanding, is more universal, it is going to be difficult to seek permission around some of the key crunchier issues. For example, you know, whether when you use your car and how much you use your car and when you use other vehicles and other transport mechanisms and when you don't travel, all of that sort of thing, it needs to have a sort of understanding. It needs an underpinning. And if we don't have that, there is a real danger, I think, that it will get increasingly difficult to bring forward some of these sorts of legislation. And the other observation I wanted to make around COP, actually, which I think is worth making, it's just an observation, but participating in marches and things, I thought it was really interesting. First of all, I mean, there's a lot of people in the marches with an awful lot of different views, which was quite entertaining. I mean, there was a very well turned out, beautifully dressed pro-nuclear lobby walking in the middle of it, which I thought was quite funny, 100 yards in front of an anti-nuclear group. But the fundamental point about it really was only that if you listen to what people were asking for and what they were speaking about, I just think there's a real danger that we have a massive rift, an intergenerational rift here, if we're not careful. That I think we really need to spend time patching up. And I think older generations have to be clear and show evidence that they're taking this seriously. Because I think we just really are in danger of sort of disappointing a whole generation. And they're really angry. I mean, listen to the comments and the chants that are, they're speaking, you know, they're shouting as they walk around Glasgow. They're not looking for small compromises and tweaks. They're looking for radical interventions. But we've got to get the majority behind, supportive of that or permissive of that, if that's actually going to work. So even though I wish we could just shout more at you guys and you could change it all for us, I suspect we need to do more work in terms of bringing the general population with us a bit more. And therefore, this issue about universal education is really, really critical.
Thank you both very much. That was very helpful.
Thank you, Monica. Fiona Hislop, please.
Mic on, please, broadcast. Yeah, thanks. Thank you very much for that. Moving, I think, from shouting back to diplomacy, and you covered some of my points I was interested in your answer to Mark Ruskell. And I'm interested particularly in the geopolitics of this and particularly the challenges ahead in advance of COP27 and what you see needs to happen. And Professor Ray, in your very good paper, you announced and declared about the importance of the just transition and what Scotland can contribute. But you also highlighted the importance of the US-South Africa coal agreement. And that didn't really get as much coverage domestically, I think, in the UK as it might have done. So I'd be interested if you wanted to unpack that a bit, but also if both of you want to be able to reflect on the role of India, the role of China, Russia, in what's happened in COP26, but more importantly, what that might mean going forward. And for Mike in particular, if you can maybe reflect also on that point about, you know, the UN is the essence of multilateralism, what you're expressing is a whole load of parallel multilateralist approaches from business, from cities, from the Under Two Alliance, etc. So if you can maybe think about the geopolitics in that sense, but maybe starting with you, Dave, if that's okay.
Thanks, Jenny. Yeah, so I think the South African funding, which was over $8 billion, included the UK actually, but US is the main contributor. And it didn't get much coverage, but it was really important because it kind of signified what needs to happen in terms of that flow of finance from the north to the global south to allow that transition to away from coal in that case, but away from fossil fuels, away from high carbon. And it was, I guess, part of, I think, what we'll see a lot more of. So Nigeria today, actually, so they've got big commitments as well to decarbonize and annual budgets like we have in Scotland in terms of carbon. But all of these nations, it's linked to what Mike was saying, they're in the context of it being highly politically sensitive. If people find that it's affecting their lives negatively and prices go up, etc., and huge numbers of livelihoods dependent on those industries, is certainly the count. I think 300,000 jobs dependent on the coal industry in South Africa, for instance. So it's kind of recognition from the US and others that you cannot just expect those nations to switch off coal without support to do that in terms of achieving that just transition. Now, for us in Scotland, obviously, we've got parallels, 100,000 people roughly dependent on the oil and gas sector. We probably cannot expect the US to give us $8 billion to help with our just transition because we are a rich nation. But we do need to actually make sure that domestically that is properly funded, the investment in terms of job creation, the stuff that obviously Jim's commission is really focused on, but also through things like the CSAP, so the Skills Action Plan. All of those mechanisms are going to be crucial in terms of doing that here. It comes back actually to us being an exemplar. We are linked very much to the just transition in terms of the phrase, but also in terms of the reality, how it's done, how the principles are applied. On the other questions, Fiona, so for India and China, so that change to phase down rather than phase out, it's an interesting one in terms of whether you see that really as just flexing those political muscles. Who's got who really holds the power now internationally? And there's probably was an element of that, but it also speaks to the reality of their domestic situation in India and the reliance on coal. But it wasn't just them. It was obviously I think it was G77 nations supported it. So India and China. So I'm very much a glass half full person. So having coal and fossil fuels in that cover text in terms of phasing down was still a breakthrough within that context of UNFCCC and getting anything into the text like that. I see that as progress. But obviously, as Mark was talking about, the way it was presented, and we all saw Alex Sharma's face as he took that on board, it wasn't the progress you would want in terms of that full commitment to phase out coal, which is where we need to get to, and fossil fuels. But it was progress. And COP27, I think that's a really good point. That gives us a very different context to Glasgow, because this will be in Egypt, and all right, that's, you count that as a kind of developed economy in many ways, but it's representing the continent of Africa. This was always going to be an African COP for the very good reason that that continent is a key area in terms of huge population, young population. If we do not manage what they're trying to do in South Africa, for instance, in terms of moving away from fossil fuel or leapfrogging, then we will have no chance of meeting the Paris climate goals. But also it is the crucible for climate change impacts already. So loss and damage, we haven't talked much about that, but that's going to be a key issue for COP27, is the dialogue in the run-up to that, whatever that form that takes, has to lead to a mechanism which allows financial flows, like Scotland has committed to, but the First Nation, I think, to actually put money up, a drop in the ocean in terms of what loss and damage actually demands. But it's going to be a key part of our fair share of meeting our climate change commitments. And that loss and damage agenda, I think, for COP27 will dominate the discussions, actually. And within that context, the big powers like India and China and the transition away from fossil fuels, so that just transition element of it, that will be really loud too, is my expectation.
And Mike, do you want to comment?
Yeah, sure. I guess one of the problems with what India did to watering down the text on the last day was partly exacerbated by a lack of consistency by the West, and particularly in terms of putting funding on the table. This $100 billion of promise has been there for a decade and hasn't materialised yet. And it left wiggle room for people to move out of the way. So I think one of the key lessons for me in that is the need for consistency in what we, in the decisions that we're making and throughout all of our decision-making processes. And I don't think we always get that right. I don't think we're as good at joined-up thinking as we could be. And I don't think it happens very often on the international stage in the way that it should. But for example, I mean, you know, Canberra was a good example. Anything like that is an obvious Achilles heel when you're standing up trying to give some moral authority to other people internationally. I do believe that there are significant alliances and possibilities here. The loss and damage that Dave was mentioning was really interesting. We sponsored the Inuit Second Polar Council to send representatives to Glasgow. And there's a huge conversation to be had just within Canada, which is reluctant to move along the loss and damage line. But of course, they've got citizens that are directly impacted and merit that support in themselves. So I actually think it changes the dynamic of the ability of that community to talk within Canada, and it will for other communities too. It gives them more leverage and more authority to actually be at the table. And I think that's really, really critical, and why even small gestures make a big difference. So for me, a lot of this comes down to leadership, and leadership requires both. It does require boldness, but we need to make sure that people support that. Otherwise, it's short-term boldness, which doesn't achieve anything. But it does require that sort of long-term consistency throughout all of the things that we do. And I think an obvious example, again, you know, we need to. Somebody much cleverer than me once said that we judge a government by its budgets, not by its rhetoric. And again, I still think there's an awful lot of space there where we could show more commitment around some of this stuff to prove that we are serious about it. And in doing so, for me, the issue is this is momentum. This is inevitable momentum globally. So you need to get on board. And if you're not on board, actually, there's a role for Scotland, because we are ahead of others. We still have a way to go. But actually, why shouldn't we use that influence to help countries like the US, Canada, Australia, even New Zealand, to actually accelerate what they're doing and take some of the fear out of it for them? And I think that would be utterly invaluable.
I completely agree with that role that Scotland can have in terms of internationally, and I've certainly in my previous role I've seen it directly and that impact. So we should never underestimate the influence that Scotland can have. And we were the first to have the first climate justice fund, however small it was, and the first on the loss and damage, however small it is. I want to ask a very probably potentially quite boring question, but it's about the Paris rulebook. Obviously, that was a success and it was completed. But who is going to police this? Who's going to make sure that this happens in terms of all the different targets and indeed the transparency that is now implicit? Is the UN mechanism strong enough to do that? And will it be ready enough to do what it needs to do in advance of COP27? Maybe David first, then Mike.
Yeah, it's a really good question. I suppose this comes back a little bit to the question about updating commitments for next year, for 2022, in terms of capacity. So one of the good things that was made clear is not every nation has the same capacity to actually report its emissions, to measure them, to even have the kind of the technical ability actually to put information into the spreadsheets in a consistent way. So actually, the UN will provide that support. So there is an overt mechanism for all nations to draw on that support, to draw training. So that capacity building element within Paris is crucial because of the 197 parties. They all have different levels of capacity. So that was really encouraging. The other thing linked to that in terms of the rule book that I found, again, really encouraging was around the market-based solutions. So one of the things which is committed to within Article 6 and the kind of, I guess, support around that is for projects, the right for communities affected, so Indigenous peoples, to be able to go to an independent body to complain, basically. So be able to take grievances to an independent body and say, look, you know, they've come along and they've thrown us out of our forest and now they're claiming it for carbon benefits, and actually, you know, not have to take that to a government body kind of domestically, but actually an independent body. So I think that was a really crucial element as well, just in terms of that capacity and those mechanisms that will make the Paris Agreement work and make those nationally determined contributions work in an equitable way. It's not perfect, but it's definitely progress again.
And Mike?
Yeah, I think, I mean, obviously so much of it is voluntary through the United Nations, and therefore I think that's why it's so important that some of this translates to legislative change and financial penalties and incentives. I think it's not just penalties. I think that's absolutely critical in order to embed this. And I think that can be done. It's only going to be done through alliances. It's only going to be done through initially progressive nations forming those alliances. And we need some consistent rules in place to ensure that we can actually deliver against this. And it isn't just the sort of hold your hands up, apologise every year when you come to COP because you didn't bother doing what you said you would do the previous year. So that's why I think frameworks like ecocide and nationalised legislation around that is really important. There's also an issue around scrutiny here as well. So it's not just around, you know, joined up thinking and making sure climate is actually in our decision making and making sure that the financial mechanisms are actually supporting the right thing and not encouraging the wrong thing. But there is also that need for scrutiny and sense checking of what's coming forward. And the closest there is, I'm aware of on the global stage at the moment, is the Elders, which is a group of previous statespeople from across the world. And they just allows them to be that little bit more holistic and sort of above politics again. And I think even domestically, I think there's a role for that. Some, you know, we've talked about a Future Generations Commission or some format where somebody is sitting and helping give that level of scrutiny. And obviously, Parliament has a very strong role there. And even financially, I would like to see, personally, I would love to see us be a bit more ambitious around funding some of this too. So I'd like to see a sort of Future Generations Fund being established, a bit like the Norwegian Sovereign Wealth Fund, because again, we've got to find mechanisms domestically and internationally to fund some of this change, or it really is going to struggle.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Fiona. Liam Kerr has a supplemental to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Yes, thanks, convener. It is important to follow the science, but if we accept, as the Climate Change Committee has said, that there will still be a major demand for oil and gas by 2050 in the UK, what does the science suggest that we do to satisfy that demand whilst minimising the climate impact? Professor Ray.
Yeah, so I mean, the key thing I guess the science tells us and the International Energy Agency kind of break new ground with this, with their statement in terms of modelling what gets us to 1.5 in the Paris Agreement, which is no investment in new oil and gas as well as coal. So in terms of that context, you then look at within the UK where we need to get to in terms of our net zero target, which is 2050, and our oil and gas demand, and look at how quickly we can phase that out. So not just phase it down, but phase it out. And I think that has to be in the context always of what is happening globally. So we've got a parallel in agriculture where if we stop producing food, and so the emissions from that, we still have to import food. So we do have to face that question, okay, if we stop oil and gas tomorrow and we're still needing it, then we have to import it. So in terms of where the atmosphere is seeing the kind of benefit, there is no benefit. We're just offshoring that. That should not stop us from going really hard at actually withdrawing our dependence on fossil fuels and looking at ensuring that we comply with that International Energy Agency scenario of not opening up new extraction for oil and gas. It's really interesting that, I guess, the political reality of COP26 in terms of a lot of emphasis on coal and a lot of nations who have moved away from coal already saying, right, you know, we need to get everyone to move away from coal. And that's quite right from the scientific perspective, but it's easily said when you're no longer relying on coal. We're in that position now where it's hard for us to say, actually, we need to get away from oil and gas because we still depend on it, 100,000 jobs, huge revenues. You know, it is a huge part of our economy. That should not stop us making the difficult decisions in terms of phasing that out as rapidly as possible in that global context of not offshoring the emissions associated with it, and also in that context of, like I say, the International Energy Agency, that we should not be investing in new oil and gas as well as coal.
Thank you for that. I'll put the same question to Mike Robinson, but perhaps I might add to it insofar as obviously, Professor Ray's addressed that question and suggested that, and it effectively equated the oil and gas industry to jobs and energy generation. But of course, the Climate Change Committee is saying there will still be a demand for oil and gas in 2050. And it's not just because of the energy generation, it's because of the uses of oil and gas in things like plastics or whatever it might be. The fact is, we are still going to need oil and gas in 2050. And the question I go back to, which Professor Ray alluded to, is where do we get that from? Because you either get it locally, Mike Robinson, or you import it, as Professor Ray pointed out. So what does the science suggest is the best way to do that, to minimise the climate impact until, let's say, 2050?
I think it's hard to say that the science has a categorical answer for that, because some of that is about choices. But as Dave pointed out, the International Energy Agency made a very strong statement that there's no requirement for new oil and gas. So we already know about enough of it, and we already know where it is. We already import quite a lot of oil, so that isn't really going to necessarily change, and maybe that's something that we just have to do. But equally, that also doesn't necessarily take account of some of the things that we may see moving forward more rapidly as price mechanisms change and price triggers change. And I think we will find an awful lot more formal recycling, particularly plastics, going forward, which hasn't been there in the past. I think there's lots of different sort of innovative interactions that you can take, interventions that you can take. But specifically, where do we buy the oil from? That isn't a scientific decision. That's not a science goal, quite honestly. Either you import it or you try and produce it yourself, I think is what you're alluding to. But there isn't. If we stick within the IEA's guidelines that there is no need for new oil, it depends whether we've got any left or not.
Thank you. Liam, Jackie Dunbar, please.
Good morning, and can I just thank you both for coming along today to talk to us. Most of my points have probably been covered already, especially in regards to what Scotland should be doing. So looking inwards, I'd like to ask you what you think the Scottish Parliament should be doing now. I know you've already said that putting politics to the side would be a good start, and decisions need to be made. But I'd really like you to maybe dig down a bit further and give me your views. And also, what expert advice should we, should the Scottish Parliament be tapping into moving forward? Sorry, I'll start with Professor Ray, please.
Thank you. Yeah, so, I mean, I've already alluded to the fact that I think for your committee, your inquiry is spot on in terms of looking at local government and their kind of cross-sectoral partners in terms of delivering net zero. I mean, I guess in terms of specifics within that, and I'm sure you've discussed this already, but looking at the role of public bodies as part of that as well. So So this is my own bias, but I think it's crucial, and it echoes what Mike was saying earlier, the capacity within local government, public bodies, the cities, the towns, that kind of local scale. What is the capacity to deliver resilient net zero? A bit like we were talking with some of the developing small states not having capacity to report effectively under the Paris Agreement. We need that capacity for action at that local level. So that would be something really important for, I think, your committee and for Parliament to make sure is there, and if it's not, ask the right questions about how it's brought forward. So looking at exemplars, so Scottish Water, who I work with a lot, I think they're a really good example of a public body which has wrestled with these things. But the duties they've got in terms of reporting, obviously they've expanded in terms of things like scope 3 emissions and indirect emissions. The governance within, for instance, local authorities, local government, is there the capacity there? The issues around procurement, I know you've talked about that a lot, and planning and transport, all of these things, adaptation, they do come back down to that that place-based approach, which again Scotland is famous for. But is there capacity to do it, not just in, say, the central belt, where we might have the equivalent of a rich country capacity for this stuff, but actually for the whole of Scotland, because it has to be the whole nation. The other things I would, if I had my wish list, I guess, for Parliament, it would be for, I guess, the conveners group, for the committees, certainly for all of you as committees, to, I guess you do talk a lot on many issues, but talk a lot about climate change, because this is whole economy, whole society, and your scrutiny, your role in that needs to be well joined up, so there aren't gaps, so there aren't parts of the economy or our society that fall through those gaps, because again, that will undermine that sustainable transition to net zero. And the final one would be, I guess you asked where you would get expertise from. So part of that is obviously the Climate Change Committee will give their latest progress report in a week or so for Scotland. And that should be a really good source of information in terms of where they see progress. I'm still really keen, and hopefully we will have a Climate Change Committee Scotland, so something which gives us that more focus, that more granular information. But also, you're probably already doing this, so forgive me if I'm teaching grandmother to suck eggs, but talk to other committees around the world. So the Climate Change Committee is a good example of at COP, they launched the international network of climate councils. So that includes various nations showing how they are giving independent advice to governments. But from this committee's perspective, talking to the US equivalent, talking to the equivalents in other nations, even at subnational level as well, to share those mistakes, share those successes, and share those challenges, I think is, it goes back to us. We always punch above our weight in Scotland in so many ways. And one of the key ways we punch above our weight is in sharing our knowledge, sharing the kind of the progress we're making. And on climate change, that's like I said several times, I was saying to Fiona, it's probably one of our biggest responsibilities, but actually one of the ways we can have our most substantial positive impact. So all of you have too much work already, I know, but that good communication and collaboration is going to be vital in terms of helping other nations do what hopefully Scotland is already starting to do.
Thank you. To hand it over to Mike Robertson, see if he'd like to add anything.
Yeah, not to add a huge amount, really. I think that sort of some of that political scrutiny, it's good to be around government departments. I still don't think it's as joined up or as shared a responsibility as it could be and should be. There's still too much of a sort of sense that it's someone else's job in some areas. So I think just scrutiny of budgets, scrutiny of public bodies, scrutiny of government departments in terms of commitments they're making, and scrutiny of public procurement, there just needs to be a sense check across the board. And so that to me is a very obvious area. I think climate change should be represented on every committee and every board in Scotland in some way, but that probably requires more universal education more generally. But equally, again, as Dave was sort of saying, I think there's another role around this, and that is that the lessons the Parliament have learned and they have shown leadership around this And other parliaments are interested in that and the processes that have been undergone to achieve that. So I think, again, like Dave was starting, looking to that sort of international arena as well, just to share those lessons more broadly.
Okay. Also, if I could ask you, Mike, you were saying earlier that some countries are dragging their heels and we need to be taking some of the fear out. With that in mind, how do you think the Scottish Parliament can help to support and develop the international best practices going forward?
I think the first thing is just finding ways to share them. Of course, we do have very strong alliances in many of these places, some informal, particularly, I mean, some, not all of them. I mean, Iran, Kazakhstan, Russia, maybe not so much, but Australia, Canada, the US, we've got very strong allegiances and very strong connections. So, and I just think it's that opportunity to say, you know, that we have actually taken some of this on board and we're still here, you know, it's not caused massive problems, we're still in a process. So I do think it probably requires looking to all the different avenues that we have to influence those societies, those communities. And I think there are a lot of connections that we have both through business, both through the NGO community, through cultural connections, as well as parliamentary ones. And I think we just need to look at leadership in all of those arenas and for support in all of those arenas. So, for me, we would just recognise that we have a positive role in encouraging them and nurturing them onto this necessary journey, and use the leaders that we have at our disposal to influence that.
Thank you. Just to finish off, convener, could ask Dave if he would like to add anything.
No, I think we've covered it. I mean, I guess. One of the capacity issues is going to be with your time, because if you look at the committees across Parliament, yours, you're in the real hot seat, I guess, over the coming years. So making sure I think SPICE are great, and hopefully you're getting good advice from academia in terms of all of our great universities and institutions. Like I say, you're going to need that and plenty of capacity in terms of all the stuff you need to look at, but it will be worth it if we have that comprehensive scrutiny that Mike was alluding to.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Jackie. Mark Ruskell, briefly, please.
Yeah, thanks. Can I just ask you if you've got any brief reflections then on what remains of the UK presidency in the run-up to COP27, what you see as the kind of key milestones or objectives that the UK needs to be aiming for? And also just the linkage with the biodiversity COP as well. I think, you know, we saw some significant text, I think, in the Glasgow Pact around biodiversity and the nature emergency. But what do you think should look like now in terms of alignment with the COP15 on biodiversity? So any brief thoughts on those would be great. Mike, do you want to go first? Oh, Dave, you got your pen up.
I was just going to pitch in quickly on the UK presidency, Mark, because that will run through until the beginning of November next year. For me, the key job, one of the most important job they've probably got, is to realise that $100 billion a year in terms of climate finance, which was failed in 2020 and now in 2021. Obviously, there's a plan in place to reach the equivalency of that by going above $100 billion a year. I think by 2023, but that's very much something that the UK needs to deliver on, because it's one of the failures even before we started COP, you know, and like Mike was saying, it clouded a lot of the discussions. It probably was a factor in the phase down rather than phase out, and that they really need to nail that. You know, I think there was a lot of good stuff, like I said, that came out of COP26. Some of it down to the UK presidency, a lot of it down to other nations' efforts as well. But that $100 billion needs to be delivered.
And any thoughts on the relation to the biodiversity COP at all?
Only that I know you talked to Jim about this last week, that it was good to see at COP26, it wasn't brand new, that actually there's that overt recognition of the crucial link between the nature crisis and the climate crisis, The nature-based solutions, kind of that whole suite of those, got a lot of attention at COP26 and will continue to do so. I think the phase two for Kunming is going to be, will very much be in the context of IPCC and IPBES in terms of their reports and the synergies. I mean, again, this is glass half full, you know what I'm like. So many synergies in terms of addressing those twin global challenges, but also the antagonisms, the issues that we've seen in terms of reduced emissions from deforestation and degradation, how it all fits into things like carbon markets and safeguarding people's rights, human rights, all of those things. It's nice the conversations are happening and it's linked together. And it's really good that the full sixth assessment report from the climate side coincides with both those COPs. So, yeah, I think we're on a good trajectory there.
Mike?
I think the critical thing, of course, is that we don't relinquish the chair until next November, and we should use it. You should use the full 12 months and not just the 2 weeks of COP. In terms of biodiversity, I do think that generally that there's a sense that that's being left behind a wee bit. There's absolutely nowhere near the same amount of focus on the biodiversity COP as there has been on the climate change COP. And yet, to a degree, they are obviously twin crises. And so I think actually just giving it the fuel of publicity and talking about it more and tackling it more head on, I think, is absolutely critical. So I think signals are really important whilst we retain the chair, and making the connections is really critical. Ultimately, I would love us to use the next few months to actually make more of a challenge. I agree with Dave. We've got to get the 100 billion commitment, because otherwise it's just too much. It's too easy to say, well, the West isn't doing what it should be doing, so why should anyone else? But I would love us still to use the months ahead to try and actually make a challenge to Egypt, so that we put our Glasgow demands to Sharm el-Sheikh. And actually use the whole of the 12-month period and not just 2 weeks.
Yep, thanks.
Thanks very much, Mark. That brings us to the end of our allotted time. Dave, Mike, thank you very much for joining us. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule and for sharing your excellent insights into some of the outcomes of COP26 and what we have to look forward to as a committee. And I use that phrase, look forward to, with as a positive challenge that you've laid out for not just this committee, but the Scottish Parliament in general. Thank you again, and enjoy the rest of your day. I now suspend the meeting for a quick changeover of panel. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone. I'm pleased to welcome our second panel of witnesses, Teresa Anderson, Climate Policy Coordinator, ActionAid International, and Coordinator of the Climate Action Network Working Group on Agriculture, Mary Church, Head of Campaigns, Friends of the Earth Scotland, and Jess Pepper, Founding Director of the Climate Cafe. Welcome to each of you. Thank you very much for joining the committee session today to look at the outcomes of COP26. I understand that Jess Pepper and Teresa Anderson would like to make a short opening statement, so perhaps I can hand over to Jess Pepper to begin and then bring in Teresa Anderson. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, and thank you for the invitation to join you this morning. I wanted just to give a brief introduction to explain the perspective that I can bring to the committee. I'm not an expert in all the technical aspects of a COP, but was taking very much more a perspective from a community angle and working with people throughout and in the lead up to COP26. Climate Cafe is a grassroots initiative which creates space for communities to have their own conversations about climate change and take action. And these spaces can be created in communities, but also in campuses and workplaces as well. And in the run-up to COP26, we were working with the Climate Reality Project, with International Network there, and the Climate Crisis Film Festival to create these spaces. In the run-up to, but also around Glasgow, working with communities and public spaces, and also online, connecting communities with across Scotland with communities around the world to engage in a dialogue about COP and what was going on in Glasgow. And the reason for doing that was partly because, of course, this is the fourth COP in the Global North, and it was important to create that space to have that dialogue and include those who could bring a perspective from the Global South as well. So just in my role today, I don't claim to be representing all climate cafes. These are spaces which are unique to the people and place where they happen, but I can hopefully contribute from a place where I'm informed by the conversations that have been going on over the last few months and throughout COP as well. And I can comment on what some of the observations are about what was going on inside the room, but also outside of the main negotiations from that perspective, if that's helpful to the committee this morning. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Jess. That's a very helpful introduction. And let me bring in Teresa Anderson, please.
Thanks very much, Kavina and the committee, for inviting ActionAid and myself to the discussions today. I'll focus my introductory remarks on two issues, loss and damage and net zero. At COP26, more than ever before, citizens from Scotland, the UK, Europe, the world really, clearly did tell their governments that they want to see the UNFCCC providing support to people who need to recover and rebuild in the aftermath of climate disasters. The public really does understand that climate action means we cannot leave the women and girls on the, and you know, the smallholder farmers, the indigenous peoples on the front lines of the climate crisis to deal with the problem on their own. Every single developing country representing the vast majority of humanity called for the UNFCCC to finally address this critical gap. So governments at COP really began to feel that pressure and talk seriously about the need for a funding facility to address loss and damage. We welcomed the initiative of the Scottish Government to announce a modest £1 million symbolic contribution to a loss and damage fund to get the ball rolling and help build pressure on the wealthier countries to acknowledge their responsibility. So given the expectation and the pressure that built on this issue, we were hugely disappointed that the US in the end didn't budge, while we were really heartened that many more countries did after hearing pressure from their citizens. So you can be sure that the issue of loss and damage will be central to climate talks next year at COP27 in Egypt. And another notable aspect of COP26 were flurry of announcements and initiatives made by governments and corporations. In some ways, this noise did feel designed to distract from the lack of real commitments in national NDCs, the lack of real climate finance, and the lack of real movements in negotiations. Although some announcements were meaningful, many of them did come with little paperwork to scrutinize. A lot of them were just outright greenwash, like a mishmash of different initiatives with no real criteria or standards, and hard to assess. It is really worrying that so many net zero climate targets are so full of carbon offsets and are set to deliver only 30 years from now. So if you add up all of the offsets hidden in all the hundreds and or thousands of net zero targets declared by governments and corporations, you do realize that there is not enough land or technological capacity to offset all the emissions from all the fossil fuels that are being dug up continuously from underground. So the maths of net zero doesn't really add up yet. We really need governments and parliamentarians and leaders and all of you to start the urgent conversation on the radical transformations and just transitions that are needed to avert runaway climate breakdown by bringing emissions down to real zero. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Teresa, I would now like to bring in Mary Church, who would also like to provide an opening statement. Mary, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks also for inviting Friends of the Earth Scotland to this session. Just listening to the evidence at last week's session and half listening to the first panel this morning, a few things to sort of open with and add to that. Our view at Friends of the Earth Scotland and also the view of our Friends of the Earth International Federation is that COP26 will be remembered as an historic failure, actually, to close the gap on 1.5 degrees and, where countries who are responsible for causing the crisis continued this pattern of trying to shift the burden of responsibility for solving the climate crisis onto the shoulders of the poorest. We heard from the speakers earlier about some of the challenges within the COP process and, what really needed to happen in Glasgow to unblock these ongoing tensions at the heart of the UNFCCC process was for the rich historical polluters, including and especially the UK as COP presidency, to really come to the table with political will and concrete policies to do their fair share of climate action. But instead, what we saw was, despite the ever-increasing urgency, despite the code red for humanity, these countries really came to the table with nothing really new or very, very little new, particularly in terms of the urgently needed climate finance. They blocked and delayed on finance for loss and damage, and they pushed through loopholes to allow themselves to keep polluting while giving the illusion of acting. For example, through the language on, a global goal for net zero around mid-century and on the deal on carbon markets. We've heard also about the inclusion of language on fossil fuels in the Glasgow Pact, and that's been hailed as historic. And of course, it is, it is historic in that it's a first in the history of the UNFCCC. That language is really incredibly weak, and not least in the fact that it really focuses on coal and ignores oil and gas largely. So once again, putting the greater onus on poorer countries to act, shifting that burden of responsibility. Just touching briefly in terms of what next and how outcomes from the COP need to be translated into Scotland. I mean, after 27 COPs, actually, it's pretty clear that, that's not really the level at which change is achieved. It's policies at the local and national level, so here in Scotland and in every nation around the world, that will really turn the climate crisis around. The important thing that Scotland can do is get on with implementing policies here at home to cut emissions and deliver a just transition. And crucially, that involves for us revisiting and strengthening the climate change plan so that we have a robust and credible roadmap to meeting our 2030 targets.
Thank you very much, Mary, and thank you for those opening remarks. They provide us with a very good context for our question session, which we move on to now. In the previous panel, we heard there were a number of positive outcomes of COP26, but also a number of gaps. And I think those gaps have been highlighted in the opening remarks on this panel. I would like to ask each of you what you see as we transition and look forward to COP27 and the remainder of the UK presidency. What would you see as the absolute critical items that have to be on the agenda and actioned ahead of and at COP27? I think you touched on some of them, but I think it would be great to hear your further thoughts in terms of the gaps remaining and the urgent actions required. Perhaps I can start with Teresa and then bring in Mary after that.
Yes, I would say that the key priorities in this area for preparation for COP26 would be moving on the issue of loss and damage and on finance, because we know that the vast majority of humanity is asking desperately for the loss and damage issue to be addressed. For context, you know, we know that there is some climate finance if you want to transition to greener pathways. There is some climate finance if you want to adapt to future impacts. But if you're hit by cyclones, by floods, by droughts, by rising sea levels, the current system says, sorry, you're on your own. And that is completely unacceptable. It was remarkable to see the pressure that built and countries shifting during the process of COP, and Scotland's initiative definitely was welcome, and we welcome Scotland's continued leadership and strengthening of that. But the US continued to be the blockage. So all the talk about alliances and global diplomacy, loss and damage has got to be a very, very key part of that. A second part is the climate finance, because if we want to unlock the global progress and movement on these cross-cutting, on if we want global language that applies to all, such as the sticky issue of coal and fossil fuels, then that needs to be underpinned and unlocked by a system that can work for all. So currently the climate finance that is being delivered, even though it is failing to meet the $100 billion target, which was set 10 years ago, by the way, that $100 billion target was pretty much plucked out of thin air by the wealthier countries. It wasn't based on a needs assessment, but it's hugely insufficient. But the majority, 71% of the funds that are coming through the climate finance system, is actually in the form of loans. So the real funds coming through to help countries, you know, recover, adapt and transition is just, you know, still peanuts. And so we are putting a huge unrealistic burden on the global south, and unfair expectations on mitigation without the follow-up for finance. And that really was the issue that underpinned those last hours of COP that was the basis of India's objection to being obliged to take on these changes without having the resources and support to be able to make those changes. So loss and damage and finance. But then I think one more thing, if I can, would be to say, it is really time that if we're serious about the 1.5 degree target, we have to stop imagining that we can solve this with small tinkering and carbon offsets. I really do not feel there is anything like the conversation needed about the deep transformative system change that is needed. And so there is an urgent, you know, beyond time need to talk about the real transformations required in our energy, agriculture, transport, construction, industry systems. We do need task forces to think about what the planet has to look like to meet 1.5 and how we get there. Because currently it feels like we're starting from where we are rather than starting from the vision and working and figuring out how to get there. So thanks for that.
Thanks very much, Teresa. Let me ask the same question of Mary Church, please.
Thanks, convener. I mean, I would agree with Teresa's comment. Certainly, closing the gap on climate finance is essential. 27. And it's important to note, I think this was partially raised in the previous panel, but this annual or this sort of review of NDCs in the year ahead of COP27, that's mitigation. So there's no urging or requiring of nations to come and have revisited their climate finance commitments ahead of 27. So that is something, you know, that's a real failing. In terms of the Glasgow Pact and the COP26 outcomes, and that's something that should be revisited by the COP presidency in the year to Egypt. Also agree with comments on loss and damage. I think the other key thing is really for the UK government, the UK presidency, you know, to get its own house in order. Showing leadership as the presidency is really important. Frankly, that's not what we saw in the run-up to COP26. You know, there were real issues around participation at the Glasgow summit. So, you know, far from being the most inclusionary COP as the UK government claimed it would be, it was actually one of the most exclusionary COPs we've ever seen. And also actions ahead of you know, cutting the overseas development aid budget earlier this year, slashing airport passenger duty in the days before the summit opened. You know, there's 40 fossil fuel projects in the pipeline in the UK, approval before 2020, including you know, the highly controversial Cambo oil field, the Whitehaven coal mine. You know, this isn't climate leadership. You know, the UK really needs to get its own house in order to show the way to other nations, to bring other nations, particularly Global North nations, along. Because just, you know, expanding on the points I made in my opening statement, what's really needed to unblock you know, the blockages in the UNFCCC process is for rich countries who've caused the crisis, you know, done most to cause the crisis. Well, with that sort of, you know, showing how they're going to do their fair share of climate action. So these long-term tensions in the COP process, they really arise around these central questions of equity, historical responsibility, capacity to act. So questions are really at the heart of climate justice.
Thanks very much, Mary. And let me bring in Jess Pepper on the same question.
Thank you. So, yeah, at COP, while, you know, there's been plenty of commentary on what was and what wasn't achieved in the talks, clearly there is a much better and wider awareness of that we were not achieving the scale and pace that is required to have a chance of staying below 1.5 degrees or to meet the needs of those who are being impacted upon most. And that, with that clarity on the urgency and the impacts, what really needs to happen now over very quickly is that the commitments that were heard in the talks, the communities need to be seeing that translated into action on the ground, and already you can hear that conversation building outside the talks, the movement of people growing in scale and momentum, the new connections, new collaborations, the new learning and insight. And credit to the COP26 Coalition and the Stop Climate Chaos Coalition, amongst many more. It's connecting communities in a new way and connecting people across different interests and experience as well. And across the world, connecting with people who are suffering the impacts on the front line in the Global South, hearing more from Indigenous peoples. All of this sharing experiences and learning and collaborating means that there's a greater literacy and understanding and urgency and impatience. Interestingly, one thing which has struck me from hearing people who have been engaged in quite a perhaps in a lighter touch way and responding to the climate emergency previously in their own communities, actually are feeling much more energised to be engaged in a much more active way. But even questioning how they should be acting, people who might not have felt that they would, you know, go out in the streets before, talking about, well, actually, do I need to be doing that now? And interestingly, I'm noticing and hearing that in a demographic which is older than previously I had noticed in these conversations. So that's been quite quite interesting to observe, but that should ensure that the delivery and the consistency of the action in response to the language and the commitments and discussion in COP26 should be coming through within the next year. And I think actually the public appetite for that is not going to be hanging back or waiting for that, but it's going to be expecting and asking and agitating for it. Issues like loss and damage, for example, I have noticed a much greater shift in understanding and discussion about climate, in terms of climate justice and in terms of loss and damage and what our responsibilities are. And it was very interesting to see that really gather pace in the world outside the talks as it came to the final conclusions inside the talks as well. So there's a lot to be done over the next year. And I think one thing which hasn't had an awful lot of light shed on it for a wider constituency, but may come, is just how the process was set up and how actually it wasn't necessarily as inclusive and accessible as it was claimed beforehand. So I think there's more to come on that, which people are asking about, having got an interest watching the talks so close to home.
Thanks very much, Jess. Each of you have mentioned increasing awareness of climate change as an issue. And during COP26, I was on a panel with Sir John Curtis, who shared some polling analysis about climate change in Scotland. He mentioned that it is increasingly becoming a very important issue for voters, but voters don't really understand what's involved, what they will be asked to do as an individual to reach the 2030 and the 2045 transition targets to net zero. Question is, I guess, do you agree with that in terms of the level of understanding of what these actions will involve? And secondly, what do you think the Scottish Government and the Parliament can do to increase those levels of awareness? And perhaps, Jess, given your background, maybe I can start with you.
Sure. So what we notice is a shift in huge number of people wanting to be involved in the conversation in a way which is appropriate for them, that they feel comfortable with. And people asking for more information, asking how they can be making a difference, what are the most impactful differences that people can make in their own lives. Obviously, in every different community, there are different needs, there are different challenges, there are different opportunities. This is why, you know, the climate cafe conversations seem to generate sometimes hyper local conversations, which then connect with a wider global conversation. There's a frustration sometimes about the lack of easily accessible information to inform people's own actions. And where that is provided, people are then talking more about, okay, how can we make this happen? And just to quote one of the climate cafes, which was held with the Glasgow Kelvin College during COP26, people were saying they need to see the commitment. We hear all the time about consistency between the promises and the rhetoric in terms of being delivered in action, but people needing to see the commitment and the investment. And this comes back to the talk about public spend and the previous panel as well, and the infrastructure to enable people to make those changes. So that's something which people do, you know, they want to see that happening, and they want, because folk want to take action themselves. It's just how they can do that and it being possible for them to do that. How can the Parliament help? Well, one of the ways which has actually come up from the Climate Cafe before, and I think I shared when the committee, the Eclair committee, were considering their green recovery thinking, was that people would really like to hear regular updates on where things are at and understand where their roles and responsibilities fit. So, you know, like we had for COVID, for example, having a route map which puts in place what was referred to last week and previously, a plan, but with all the timetables and resources and milestones to ensure that we know where we're going and we all understand our roles and responsibilities, and achieving that is something which people would welcome. And they would welcome regular updates to hear, you know, what progress is being made there and how they fit. And that would flush out where action is being easily achieved or where there's perhaps some confusion or under-resourcing, or also where there are challenges, so those can be removed and tackled, rather than it all accumulating for, say, a year and then discovering that actually something's been holding up progress all the time. And people could feel, you know, okay, this is overwhelming, but actually I get my role in this now, and I see where others, like my local authority or these public bodies or these businesses are going to play their role as well, and that would make it more accessible and transparent and accountable to people. That seems to be a feedback we've heard.
That's great. Thank you very much, Jess. Same question to Mary Church, please.
Thanks, convener. I mean, as with Jess, I think people do understand, you know, not just that the reality of the climate crisis is already with us, right? They're seeing and experiencing, in some cases, the impacts of the climate crisis already here in Scotland, in other countries of the global north. You know, this is no longer a case of simply seeing impacts in the most vulnerable countries, but also here in the relatively insulated global north as well. So, you know, they've heard the warnings from the IPCC, the 1.5 report, the Code Red report earlier this year. You know, they see loud and clear that climate change is an issue. They want governments to act. They want the Parliament to act. And I think they do know what the solutions to the climate crisis are, but where there's confusion is about the, you know, the lack of clear plans from the government side about you know, what will be implemented when. So they know that fossil fuels need to be phased out, for example. They know that, you know, we need to shift from private car use to public transport, etc. But what they're not seeing is those concrete plans to deliver on that. And that's, you know, that's something that the government and the parliament obviously need to deliver on. You know, it's worth sort of reflecting that the Code Red earlier this year, you know, the warning from the IPCC is that we will be hitting, we will be reaching 1.5 degrees of warming within the next decade. And, you know, only a few years ago, the sort of the timescales that we were talking about, they were all quite sort of far off. And it felt very safe, or for some of us, perhaps, it felt very safe, you know, happily underground by 2050 and not having to worry about the impacts at that stage. But, you know, to think about 1.5 and the impacts of 1.5 hitting within the next decade, you know, pretty much everyone, you know, around the table and virtually around the table in this room will still be around then. And those of us in, you know, decision-making positions, we will be held accountable for, you know, what we have and haven't done to deliver on, you know, our climate targets to avoid that really critical 1.5 threshold.
Thanks very much, Mary. And the same question to Theresa Anderson, please.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, individual action in the absence of government policy to incentivize the right thing can remain niche. But there is definitely a very fruitful and synergistic relationship between public knowledge and expectation and what makes things possible politically. Because, like, people, as we saw with the experience with loss and damage and climate justice that Jess alluded to as well, you know, people change the safe space for governments to move into. You know, create an excitement about just transition, an expectation to deliver on solidarity and climate finance. So there is a clear role for civil society in shaping the expectations, as we've seen this COP has been a huge success in that. And there is a role of government to identify where subsidies and tariffs and investments, policies and regulations, like, currently incentivize the wrong kind of action and actually make it hard for individuals to do the right thing, and where these can be shifted. And how that can be done through inclusive processes that address inequality, that enable change through planning and policies and reskilling and social protection. So there's a real synergistic role between that. But I think we shouldn't be expecting the individuals to be leading on this without the government policies in place to really make the right things possible.
Thank you very much. Theresa, Mark Roskell has a supplemental in this area to be followed by Fiona Hislop. But please go ahead. That's fine.
Okay. A slightly different question. I mean, in the final Glasgow text, there was, I think, for the first time, a recognition of a just transition. But I'm wondering about what the definition of that is, because when I was in the blue zone, I was walking around all of the country pavilions from the oil and gas producing states. And I think, you know, their definition seemed to be, we're going to continue extracting oil and gas because, you know, we need it. We're going to continue burning it. And we're going to make that just transition by investing in carbon capture and storage and blue hydrogen. So that seemed to be one kind of definition of just transition. On the other hand, you had states forming the Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance, where they're actually saying phase out, but over time, not turning the taps off overnight on oil and gas. So there seems to be a lot of different interpretations there, and I just wondered what your kind of views were of where that global conversation is, and do we have clarity here on what a just transition for oil and gas actually looks like? Mary, should we start with you?
Yeah, thanks for that, Mark. Just transition does appear in the text couple of times. It's not actually the first time. Just transition was included in the preamble of the Paris Agreement as well, and it's pretty much the same language that's been taken from the Paris Agreement into the Glasgow Pact. There's also an additional inclusion of language around just transition specifically in relation the inclusion of the text around fossil fuels, but it also appears there that's maybe the new base in which it comes up. And of course, that part of the text, you know, there's been a lot of scrutiny of that part of the text in terms of the watering down at the last minute. And arguably, yeah, you're right, the inclusion of just transition in that part of the text and the language around unabated coal and inefficient fossil fuel subsidies, arguably that risks the really important concept of just transition being used to eke out an existence for fossil fuels and to you know, put our faith in these sort of really false solutions, these sort of dangerous distractions that are carbon capture and storage and other such negative emissions technologies. In terms of what just transition needs to look like, I mean, certainly where we're coming from, it must involve the phase out of all fossil fuels, and that's got to be global. You know, that also has to happen in an equitable fashion. And I think a lot of the criticism that India and China got for those last minute interventions, you know, and that perception of watering down of the text was really because India was trying to just inject a bit of balance, inject a bit of equity back into the text, you know, away from this sort of this focus on coal. You know, what we would see, there was actually a report that was published, which we can share with the committee afterwards if that would be helpful, a report that was published by a broad coalition of international civil society groups called the Civil Society Review, released during the COP, about what a fair shares phase out of fossil fuels would look like globally. And what that says is it sort of discusses five principles for a fair shares phase out, and the first of which is phasing down global extraction at a pace consistent with 1.5 degrees, which is obvious. You know, we can't, you know, continue to prioritise fossil fuel profits over the lives of billions of people around the world. It calls for a just transition for workers and communities, so the creation of decent green jobs, protection of rights and livelihoods, ensuring that unions and workers and affected communities are the actors in the shift to zero carbon. It calls for curbing extraction consistent with environmental justice, so a phase out first where people and the environment are disproportionately harmed by extraction. And it calls also, and this is crucial in terms of, you know, UK and Scotland as first movers, it calls for reducing extraction fastest where doing so would have the least social cost. So poorer countries and countries where fossil fuels are, you know, a disproportionately high part of the economy are much more at risk from an abrupt and shorter term transition. And so rich historical polluters really must phase out first. You know, in terms of the UK, you know, it's a very, really relatively very small part of our economy. Only 0.1% of public revenue comes from fossil fuel extraction. And then the fifth principle is in terms of sharing the costs of the transition fairly according to the ability to pay. So rich historical polluters supporting the phase out in the global south through the provision of climate finance and technology.
Okay, thanks. Teresa?
Yes, oh, yeah, hi. So yeah, the term just transition was developed and lifted up really by the unions. So it is taken largely by the vast majority of us to be an approach that centers workers. As ActionAid, we took the lessons of just transition in fossil fuels and thought about what that would mean when we applied them to agriculture, because we also recognize we need a shift from polluting industrialized agricultural systems to ways that work with nature like agroecology. So we thought about what that would mean. And in that process, we came up with four principles, which I'll share here because I think they might help anyway. I mean, there are ActionAid principles, but they have had some influence in the sector, and they've also been agreed, like our colleagues at the ITUC, the International Trade Union Confederation, liked that framing too. The first principle that we identify is that a just transition needs to address and not exacerbate inequality. It needs to transform systems to work for people, nature, and the climate. It needs to be inclusive and participatory processes. So that means including the people who will be effective in shaping a future that can be better for them. But it also means including the people who are often invisible and left out and not really recognized in the system, like the members of the community, the women who are all part of that livelihood, but who aren't necessarily the direct workers themselves. Including that broader marginalized community in that conversation, because this affects them just as much as anyone. Fourth point is about having comprehensive planning and policy frameworks. So, you know, you can have these at regional or local or national level, but also bearing in mind the role of training and reskilling and education, social protection, the role of subsidies, climate finance, really having an integrated policy framework that helps all of this to happen and helps communities to make the shift to a better future. And if done well, a just transition can really help communities that might otherwise block and resist change to really welcome it and be enthusiastic about it. So that's why we developed those principles. We note that the term just transition does currently tend to focus on the livelihoods issue, and the issue when it comes to fossil fuels anyway is broader than that. It's also about energy. It's also about the tax base for many, you know, for some countries like Nigeria, it's like something like 70% of their tax base. So that is real issues that need to be resolved. We need to check those numbers that it was Nigeria, but if I remember correctly, it was... would be. So diversification is really, really critical to that just transition. But like many terms, you know, these can in some spaces be co-opted. I'm not currently too alarmed that the term just transition is being used in these sort of very superficial ways. At the moment, most people are still using it in a way that centers justice in the thinking and forces us to think about the most marginalized rather than the most powerful.
Thanks. And Jess?
Yeah, I can't comment to the text and finally at COP itself, but would just acknowledge that these conversations about just transition are happening in communities and were happening in parts of Glasgow during the COP process, obviously inspired and informed by wider conversations about just transition, but the smaller stories about what that looks like and feels like in communities. And I just would acknowledge that system approach is so important to enabling to the just transition. But the principles that Tadeza has just outlined actually, when talking about how Scotland can be approaching the work that we need to be doing and how the Parliament can be supporting that work, those are the principles which we keep coming back to in terms of including and participation and the comprehensive framework. Just having all of that in place and enhancing rather than exacerbating, enhancing inequalities rather than exacerbating inequalities. These are all principles of that whole wider conversation that we can apply in terms of how the Parliament may be able to support this transition as well, which would be valued from the local level right through to those who want that certainty in business and for planning in their own way as well.
Thank you, Mark. Fiona Hislop to be followed by Monica Lennon.
Thank you. I'm very interested in the geopolitical challenges ahead of COP27. Other colleagues will talk about the domestic aspects to reflecting on Scotland. I was interested, Mary, in what you were saying in relation to climate finance. We know that loss and damage is going to be huge for the next year, but the climate finance points that you were saying about the sense of realism, perhaps, that the China-India intervention brought. What do you think that means now in order to try and advance the position of phasing out of coal in India? What would need to be realised in terms of that climate, finance that we spoke of. And particularly for you, Theresa, the same question is about the geopolitics of the likes of the role of China and Russia and India from COP26 and where we go forward. But also, what are your international networks telling you? What is the, I suppose, the global citizenry telling you as a result of the COP26 and the Glasgow Pact? So Mary first and then to Theresa.
So thanks for that. I think in terms of the climate finance, it's part of this sort of coming to the table and showing, that we in the Global North sort of understand our responsibility in causing the problem and that we're prepared to take that responsibility on and act, right? And that's what will bring the likes of China and India forward in their commitments too. And it is actually worth saying that, this fair shares analysis, so fair shares analysis is work done actually again by that same wide coalition of civil society organisations internationally. It's rooted in so the Climate Equity Reference Group, which the analysis is rooted in the Climate Equity Reference Group, which takes the principles from the UNFCCC. So it takes the principles of equity, of historical responsibility, of common but differentiated responsibility. It takes the science of remaining carbon budgets. It looks at development thresholds, so it looks at the right to develop cleanly for countries of the Global South, which is also enshrined in the UNFCCC. So their right to, what's remaining of the atmospheric space to pollute, essentially, it's sort of that crudely. It takes all of those elements and it comes up with an analysis of who needs to do what, right, in terms of emissions reductions and in terms of climate finance. And what it found was, back in 2014-15, ahead of the Paris Agreement, it found that most developing countries, including China and India, were actually already committed to doing, their fair share or more of climate action. And really, where things were failing, where falling down, were Global North countries failing to step up and cut their emissions fast enough and provide that vital climate finance. Because, of course, developing country NDCs, there's the conditional and unconditional part of those. The conditional part is reliant on Global North climate finance, technology transfer and other forms of so the kind of climate finance and the kind of action that we need to see, based on this climate equity reference group analysis, we produced some work looking at what the UK's fair share would be, and that showed that if the UK was to reduce its own emissions to zero by 2030. So actually the UK's fair share was to reduce its own emissions by 200% by 2030, which of course is physically impossible, right? But if it was to reduce its own emissions to zero, which is physically possible, by 2030, then it would be, it would owe something in the region of $1 trillion of climate finance to the Global South, right? Now that's a lot of money, it sounds, and obviously we're, the UK's climate targets only get to net zero by 2050. So, the way it works is if you're only getting to net zero by 2050 rather than 2030, what you owe in climate finance obviously goes up to compensate for that. The big numbers, $1 trillion, but actually, what we've seen over the last, over the last few years, but also over the last decade is, the governments can mobilise and they do mobilise this kind of finance when they think they need to. So, we saw with the bailout of the banks in 2007-2008 that the sums in excess of $1 trillion were mobilised to support the banks when it was considered that they were too big to fail. our planet is too big to fail, right? Our ecosystems are too big to fail. This crisis is too big to ignore. More recently, we've also seen the kind of sums that have been mobilised both here in the UK and globally to respond to the COVID crisis, in the trillions as well. So this kind of finance, it is available. Governments can come up with it, and they really must come up with it if we're to see that kind of corresponding action from countries who are, you know, big polluters in terms of, you know, the amount that they're emitting within their borders today, not necessarily such big polluters in terms of their per capita emissions, and, you know, certainly not big polluters in terms of their historical responsibility.
Thank you. And Teresa?
Yeah, I would say in terms of the international networks and attitudes to the Glasgow Pact, I mean, the rhetoric inside the UK is quite different from the rest of the world. The rest of the world really sees it as the global north countries continuing to block action, climate action and climate finance. You know, so we came in to this process with this failure to meet the 100 billion target set a decade ago. The target is insufficient. The majority of it is loans. Most of what is coming through is going towards mitigation, which is in the interest of the global north, little on adaptation and nothing on loss and damage. So there's a real sense and a real skepticism around the world that, you know, that the rich countries, when they talk about climate action, it's entirely self-interested. And, you know, that they want others to fix the problem on mitigation without really wanting to do much themselves or provide what is needed to make it happen. So a lot of bluffing and cynicism around, really. China and India, they are often seen as speaking for themselves in isolation. But let's not forget, they often speak with their G77 hat on as part of the wider bloc when they express their concerns about equity. And so that as Mary has outlined, there is real defensiveness and concern about the pressure for global south countries who simply do not have the resources to undertake the mitigation without the required support. Because if you put yourself in the shoes of a vulnerable country, dealing with the aftermath of a cyclone, whatever little resources you have are going to spend on rebuild and recovery, and you still don't have enough to help communities bridge the gap and avoid falling into a poverty spiral. You don't have enough to help people rebuild their schools and or their homes or avoid hunger. But whatever you do, you spend on that. And if you have any pennies left, you want to spend it on becoming resilient to future impacts. But it's simply not, when you're being pummeled by disasters, it is simply not in your own interest to plow the money into windmills when you're not even the ones that caused the problem in the first place. So that is why there is this whole different take from a very different starting point from the Global South, and finance and equity and responsibility are the key points about this.
Thank you. And I'm conscious we want to bring our colleagues in, but I was interested, Teresa, in what you were saying about the maths of the carbon offset not matching necessarily the land available globally. And obviously that's quite a challenge and interesting from a Scottish perspective. But I'd like to hear a bit more about that, but conscious of time, with the convener's permission, I think it would be helpful to maybe get some insight to that reference that you made.
Thank you. Yes. Well, to give an example, we as ActionAid looked at Shell's net zero climate target, and on their pathway to net zero by 2050, they've given the details of what they plan to do in the next 10 years on their way to zero by 2050. But just by 2030, they would require land three times the size of the Netherlands, which is ironic for a Dutch, once Dutch company. They just actually changed a few weeks ago, declared they were moving back to the UK. But it was, of course, they're not planning to plant trees. They're not planning to plant trees and do offsetting in the Netherlands. They're not planning all the Netherlands neighbours. They're planning to plant large amount of trees, largely in the global north. And we've seen through the biofuels experience that happened between, you know, that really escalated between 2007 and 2012, how a supposed climate solution really ended up putting a huge burden on land and a huge burden on smallholder farmers, women, indigenous communities, and replacing forests, leading to hunger, rising food prices, displacement, completely inequitable and completely impossible to achieve on a global scale. And if you consider that the story of Shell is just one target, net zero target, out of all the thousands of net zero targets that are out there, so many net zero targets are not claiming net zero by 2050 without undertaking the radical transformations needed now in these years and decades, and relying very heavily on land assumptions or future technologies that they hope will come along and save them in the future, but will probably never be possible. So we should not be lulled into a false sense of security by all these net zero targets. We really have to scrutinize them and say, are they bringing about the transformation that we need? And in the vast majority of cases, they are.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Fiona. Monica Lennon, please.
Thank you, convener. I'm mindful of time, so I might just try and lump a few things into one question, and please feel free to respond to the parts that are most relevant to you. I want to return to Just Transition, and I refer to my register of interest as a member of Unite the Union and the GMB Union. At Glasgow, we saw in a very public way the coming together of the climate strikers and environmentalists with workers and with trade unions. So I think that's a positive. But in terms of where the public are, it appears that people are believing the science and are following the science. But from a worker's point of view, I think many people are still quite sceptical about the ability of politicians and governments to deliver a just transition, because I've never really seen a just transition be delivered before. So what needs to happen to make that just transition happen? Mary, you talked about strengthening the climate change plan, and you talked about a credible roadmap. I think Jess touched on a route map as well. So from the conversations you've had with people at COP, you know, what are people looking to happen at a national level? And just on this issue of greenwashing, because I think we did see and hear a lot of that ahead of COP and even during it in the Blue Zone, what can we do in terms of public and political education to be able to see greenwashing or understand it when we see it, a bit like fake news? And often we talk about education for children and young people in school, but as a thread to run through, you know, all our lives lifelong, how can we make sure that the public have the right tools to be properly engaged in the conversation and call out things like greenwashing when they see it? And maybe start with Mary first.
Yeah, thanks, Monica, for that. And yeah, I would also agree, you know, that was one of the really positive things that we saw in Glasgow, was that coming together of, you know, the youth climate strikers, the climate justice movement on the picket lines, with, you know, the workers in really essential services. And it's, you know, it's worth reminding ourselves that, you know, the big strikes, the key sort of, or the high profile strikes that were happening during and ahead of the COP, you know, they were really around the delivery of essential services. So the refuse workers and the rail workers striking for decent pay and conditions, you know, for essential services. And, you know, these are a key part of the response to the climate crisis, right? So when you think about the need to shift to circular economy, refuse workers and that waste infrastructure is absolutely key to delivering on the circular economy. And of course, the railways, public transport is absolutely key to delivering on that shift away from the private car, and to really tackle those, you know, that so far very difficult to tackle transport emissions. I mean, I think you touched on the answers really in your question in terms of what workers need to see to be convinced about the just transition, and that is clear plans, right? It's clear plans, it's timescales. You know, it's not just the workers that need to see that, but it's also the industry that needs to see that. Clear plans and clear timescales. They need to see investment. They need to see policies, right? Policies that are going to show how they will be supported out of one job, out of one industry into another, that show how their skills, you know, the skills that they already have will be transferred into the new green economy. And, you know, it is worth reflecting that, you know, the past transitions, the past energy transitions in this country largely have been unjust transitions. You know, probably nobody around the table needs reminding about, you know, the transition away from coal and the damage that's done and you know, that continues to do and be embedded in many communities around Scotland. But then also looking to the more positive and, you know, thinking, you know, that this really can be done, is looking actually at the oil and gas industry. And remembering that, you know, in 1969, that was the first year that we drilled a single drop of oil from the North Sea, was 1969. And only 12 years later, the UK was an exporter in gas. And another 3 years after that, we were one of the world's top five exporters of oil and gas. So within sort of 15 years, we went from drilling no oil and gas to being one of the top exporters. And that's the kind of timescale that we need to move away from fossil fuels in Scotland and in the UK. And it can be done. It has been done. It just requires government intervention and government planning, and it requires public finance. And, you know, on the point of finance, you know, where's the money going to come from this? Well, you just, again, have to look at the fossil fuel industry and all the subsidies that are going towards that. They clearly need to be shifted away from fossil fuels and into the renewables industry and the sort of wider green economy.
Thank you, Mary. I'm coming next to Teresa and then to Jess. Thanks.
Yeah, and I fully agree with all of that. And to say that on just transition, I think a key of that will be inclusive processes as well, to involve people rather than just give them something which they feel doesn't address their multitude of needs. On the greenwashing, well, we just to relate what we saw at COP, we saw many, many announcements without really any a lot of these didn't have clear criteria. But some of them were just like, particularly on agriculture, which I was following more closely, we saw an announcement that 40 countries declare something on agriculture, but there was no real standard or criteria. So it was a huge mishmash of God knows what, really, without any paperwork to really understand what it was all about. And then if you look closely, some of these were really just industry trying desperately to stay relevant because they see the writing on the wall. They see that the IPCC and the special report on land and climate made it clear that we have to shift away from these systems towards, you know, agroecology and better systems that work for the planet. So it was a desperate attempt to stay relevant without really any criteria or standards or exclusions on what real action needs to look like. So what we actually need to see to avoid greenwash, I could name a number of things. For example, criteria before these initiatives get launched and before everybody joins the club and has a chance to weaken it. Making sure that announcements are linked clearly to NDCs, because we had no sense of what all these announcements meant in real terms of national action and what their contribution was to 1.5. Also, the offsets issue, you know, with all these net zero announcements, given the minimal global capacity to really offset, you know, the limited amount of land that we have that's cleared for new tree plantations, it is safer to assume that most offsets can't really be achieved, or if one, you know, company manages to, the others won't. So easier to dismiss or just take as assumption that and just actually require real transformation. And another thing is to consider, we need more discussion about how to scale down things, not just scaling up everything, not just making bad things slightly better. We really need to see how to take the things that are a problem out of the equation, but do so in a fair and just way. And so that's where the just transition thing links very closely to the attempts to address greenwash.
Thanks, Teresa. I just wondered, Jess, when you're giving your answer, could you also reflect on your earlier or opening remarks about the public being energised and public expectations? I'm just trying to think about what is the legacy of COP26 for people here in Scotland. So interested to hear your thoughts.
Okay, I'm trying to remember to cover all that. So on just transition, I would agree with all the previous comments and also acknowledge that need for participation and, you know, at whatever level, whether that's, you know, thinking about a whole sector or at a community level, people need to be engaged and involved in that process. And sometimes we're worried that that might slow the pace down when we urgently need to be making progress. But actually, our experience is that once people feel confident and engaged in a process that they trust, that actually that can accelerate the process and bring with it a momentum and an energy that also, importantly, delivers an outcome that is workable for people rather than something which was designed centrally and sort of put to people. So that engagement. I think the important word there is shift about, you know, these things have to be financed, whether it's in energy, shifting to clean energy or in transport, that shift has to happen. And that's one of the areas which I hear constantly about people, you know, the kind of they want to be doing their bit, but they need that system change and they're frustrated because they see that the system is still favouring the old story rather than the new story. And that shift needs to happen. And it needs to open, you know, in order to see that happen, we need to open things up and be constantly scrutinising whether it's not happening or not happening. You know, is that ambition being translated into the national planning framework or into the strategic planning on transport, for example? And if it's not, then people lose hope and they also lose their own engagement with that being part of that transition. Greenwashing, interestingly, one thing which I think we've just seen the start of through COP is some unpacking of those previously, you know, solutions that, you know, CCS, for example, hydrogen. We talk a lot about hydrogen without necessarily distinguishing the different types of hydrogen. And we're before COP, we were hearing a lot of questions about hydrogen, you know, within community conversations. What does it mean? What, you know, I don't feel knowledgeable about what the differences are, what the choices are there, where can it be used, where can't it be used? And actually, once that's unpacked, people feel a lot more confident in their own knowledge, and it informs them in terms of what they are listening to, whether they're talking about green hydrogen or blue hydrogen, or what the different implications are for all of those. Interestingly, no, I wouldn't like at all to give the impression that communities are not informed, but obviously everybody is on a scale and people always want more information to inform their own contributions and their own actions and their own lives. And also, you know, people are anxious, of course, because they're seeing impacts, but they also care about the impacts which are coming quickly to others as well. That information that access to understanding what is going on. So part of the contribution towards these climate conversations in communities has been through the Climate Reality Project, where you get a summary of what the climate science, the impacts and the solutions are. And these are global sort of snapshots of some of the solutions. And once people hear that stuff and put together, join the dots between their own knowledge of what is going on in terms of the science and the impacts and what the solutions might be, just hear a confidence and a knowledge in the discussions that then folk just take on for themselves. And there's something in that that I think we need to harness as a nation, where everybody has access to the information and the resources that they need in order to inform their own conversations, rather than having to, you know, pick and choose and work out what to believe or what to trust. So and actually, once folk have that conversation going on themselves, just to bring in that energy and momentum. They bring that energy and momentum in their own lives and their own experiences, whether they're in health or education or wherever. And it can actually fuel a really valuable dialogue, for example, with local government, where people can be saying, right, this is what we want to be doing. We do want to make that switch from our cars to public transport and active travel, but we're feeling we can't do that because we don't have a safe route to cycle between our communities, for example. And then they can start to have a really meaningful conversation with local government, public bodies. And what we hear from local government is that they really value that, because it's not a sort of finger waving exercise at each other. It's a dialogue which is actually producing a roadmap to how they can be delivering change. And so, yeah, that's, I think, a real potential there to bring people what they need and harness that energy. We could take that momentum that we've really accelerated through hosting COP26. And apply it in that way. But communities, in that same participation way as I talk about with the Just Transition, need to be brought into the conversation. And at the moment, what we're not hearing very well is first-hand experience from people across communities, and not just those who you'd expect to hear from all communities, going to them, hearing what their experiences are, what their needs are, what their challenges are, and bringing that to the heart of the conversation. And that could be an area where the Parliament could really help ensure that happens.
Thank you to our panel.
Thanks very much, Monica. Let me bring in Jackie Dunbar, please.
I'll be brief, convener, because I'm conscious of the time. Can I ask each one of the panel, what is the one thing that you think the Scottish Parliament should be doing, and what expert advice do you think we should also be tapping into? Can I go to Jess first, please, because I think you just touched on that briefly, if I'm reading your mind, Jess.
I think, and I'd refer to previous comments about keeping this conversation going, and also perhaps pick up on Dave Ray's comments about the fact that it all is landing on one committee. But Parliament as a whole needs to keep this conversation going, and scrutiny of budgets and public spend, ensuring everything that across all committees, whether it's in health and education or wherever it is in line with tackling the climate and the nature emergency. And I could reel off a list of things which have been talked about over 20 years probably about what people would like to see, but that mainstreams that really brings that to the heart of everything that we do, because people can then trust and look to that process, to that structure in the building, which is bringing the conversation back to the people, which I think could be really, really valuable, and bringing in all those, that would bring the openness and transparency, accountability, and participation that are obviously going to be so key to making progress, which we can refer to elsewhere.
Okay, thank you. Can we go to Mary, please?
Yes, thanks. I think the one thing that this committee could be doing is really doing the job that its predecessor committee set out back in the spring, and really holding the government to account on the climate change plan update, the missed targets. So, we saw there were 166 points that your predecessor committee flagged up as wanting to be addressed in terms of the climate change plan update, and also the committee asked for a credible plan B, right, away from this sort of over-reliance on negative emissions technologies that we saw in the climate change plan update. So, not just going for the residual emissions being captured by CCS, but, one-fifth by 2040, by 2032. And, those dates don't align with industry projections of when that technology would come on stream. And obviously we have serious reservations about whether that technology will ever come on stream, but even the industry isn't claiming to be able to mop up that amount within that timescale. So really this committee needs to be holding the government to account on those points flagged back in spring. We've also seen the recent Section 36 update plan, which was a response to the missed target, and I think that has been laid before Parliament as per the regulations. I don't think there's a requirement for this committee or any committee to scrutinise it, but I think it would be strongly advisable for this committee to do so. So it's a, it's a 15 page, it's not a very long report. There's some positive things in there, mostly that are taken from the manifesto, the cooperation agreement, and the programme for government, and a couple of new extra things on top of that. But there are no numbers in that update report, so it's very hard to tell whether it's credible. So I think it'd be great if you could have a look at the report, get the minister in front of you, and ask some difficult questions of that. In terms of who else you should be listening to, what other expert advice? I mean, there are lots of experts out there. I think, really listening to what civil society are saying would be, useful for this committee. So I've mentioned once or twice the work of the civil society review that's available. We can forward you those reports. If that would also, tune in, the work that the COP26 coalition did around the Glasgow summit. We ran over the course of the 2 years, we ran several people summits online ahead of the COP. We run a hybrid in-person and online people summit during the COP, and many of those sessions were captured and recorded, and you know, what people were discussing, you know, the impacts of the climate crisis, but also the solutions to the climate crisis in many of those sessions. And I think you could learn a lot from going back to those sessions and tuning in and listening, both in terms of what we need to do and also just in terms of, you know, the real public appetite for change and the real anger, you know, the sense that, you know, that's sorry if I can sort of expand a bit, but in that sense of, you know, perhaps, you know, I and we as Friends of the Earth haven't come across as very hopeful in terms of the outcome of COP26, but actually where we do or hope from is in this really powerful, you know, movement of movements that we've helped to instigate, but that we've seen growing, you know, beyond our hopes for that. And, you know, that's going to continue to act together and to hold decision makers to account until we get the change that we need.
Do we have time to go to Theresa, convener?
Very briefly.
Thank you very much. So I'm quite heartened by the real willingness of this committee to be a world leader and to push itself and the world. And so to take forward the movement already shown by Scotland on loss and damage finance and just transition, these are really key. So continue to push the boat on these because they've proven very helpful in the global conversation. But also asking the right conversations on what is not being asked, you know. So initiating conversations, possibly a task force for real transformation, you know, what is a fair share of 1.5 and how to really get there, what is really required, that can spark and inspire the world and, you know, maybe make a real difference on getting the planet on track. Maybe even a task force to look at how money is being spent and where it could be better spent. These are real issues that are still nowhere in the conversation and yet are essential to it.
Thank you very much, Jackie. That brings us to the end of our allotted time. And let me thank our guests for joining us today. It was a very interesting panel. Thank you for your insights in relation to the outcomes of COP26 and the wide range of other issues you brought to our attention. Enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you very much. And that brings us to the end of the public session.